Good evening. My name is Clifford Brooks, and welcome to Dante's Old South. The show is a cool gathering of kind men and women affiliated with the Southern Collective Experience and, as usual, broadcast from the generous hearts of those behind WUTC here in gorgeous Chattanooga, Tennessee. I would like to thank all of you for tuning in, and I pray that all of you enjoy the poems, essays, music, and personal stories from all walks of life. To provide our first-time listeners with a bit of background, the Southern Collective Experience is an organization founded around 5 years ago after I wrote my first book, The Draw Broken Eyes and Whirling Metaphysics. The Southern Collective Experience is a group of men and women who not only dream of being an artist, but have gained success in that endeavor. We promote and provide personal support within our ranks and without, to show through doing that not all of our ilk are incapable of sharing the stage. The goal of the collective is to promote the arts in all its forms and prove that creative minds are able to balance their dreamscapes as well as their checkbooks. We do that through social media, a magazine called the Blue Mountain Review, and shows like this. You can find all of this and more by visiting our website, www.southerncollectiveexperience.com. If you wish to help get the word out, shoot us a message from our site, and we'll send you some suggestions. In today's show, we have music from the Orange Walls, Caleb Garrett and D.L. Yancey II. There's poetry from Hani Zweibel, Scott Thomas Outler, T.C. Carter, and yours truly. You'll be reminded to smile by Miss Holly Holt, and then learn about an upcoming weekend of literary seminars provided by Marianne Stefanelli. To help me move the show forward with some semblance of grace is veteran radio personality Matt Youngblood from WYYZ 1490 AM, who is not only a member of the group, but the man responsible for getting Dante's Old South off the ground. So, let's get started. I will step away from the mic and let Matt Youngblood ease up to walk us through the program. Again, thank you for tuning in, and I hope that you get your fill of Dante's Old South, where listeners hear songs, stories, stanzas, and their real-world applications.
To start off the tone of the show that has music that pours not only through the words but through the spirit itself, we welcome Mr. D.L. Yancey II. How are you today, sir?
Doing well. How are you?
Doing well. What song will you be sharing with us?
I'll be sharing a song titled The Layover. I wrote it a few months back, and I read one of Cliff's poems called A Promise to Mama, and while reading that poem, I was trying to think of a new song to write, but it reminded me so much of the song I've already written called The Layover. And for this song, I kind of imagine an old man sitting on a rustic old front porch in an old type of rocking chair, and beside him is a suitcase. And the whole theory of the song is he had dreams and aspirations to fulfill and to do, and he had quests to conquer, but he never left his front porch. So the title of the song is called The Layover, and that's kind of the gist of it.
Wow, and being spurred by a creative idea is almost two ideas coming together to form something new and coming out of it really is incredible.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think a portion of the poem that struck me the most was it sounded like an internal struggle that the writer was going through and was trying to express that struggle to his mother, and was kind of at the end promising her, okay, I'm going to leave, and I'm going to fulfill this thing one day.
Wow, and we'd feel honored if you'd be gracious enough to share it with us.
Absolutely. Call The Layover.
Said I'm sitting here watching the time go by, and it's rolling down the runway of life, and it spreads its wings and takes off in flight, and I'm watching it disappear into the sky. It leaves me wondering What am I doing? I should be on that plane at an elevation conducive to the goals I made. Whoa, society's moving and times will change, but it's time that I'm losing, 'cause I'm waiting for my day to come. I'm changing. Said I'm waiting for my day to come, but it ain't coming. I said I'm waiting for that day to come, and should I chase it and leave everything behind and replace it with risk and opportunity, or should I take it? A chance to court uncertainty, or just waste it? A chance with opportunity, let's just face it. I'm comfortable just imagining, procrastinating, entertaining the thoughts inside me. So I'm sitting here watching the time go by, and it's rolling down the runway of life, and it spreads its wings and takes off in flight, and I'm watching it disappear into the sky. It leaves me wondering, what am I doing? I should be on that plane at an elevation conducive to the goals I made. Whoa, society's moving and times will change, but it's time that I'm losing, 'cause I'm waiting for things to change, but they ain't changing, 'cause everything I do remains the same. I'm complacent and blaming circumstances for my laziness and lack of motivation to take over it. Desire and to fire, yes, control this mess. Uncertainty into certainty, yes, oh yes, oh yes. My bags are packed, oh yes, oh yes. But this monkey's on my back, so I'm sitting here watching the time go by, and it's rolling down the runway of life, and it spreads its wings and takes off in flight, and I'm watching it disappear into the sky. It leaves me wondering, what am I doing? I should be on that plane, an elevation conducive to the goals I made. Whoa, society's moving and times will change, and it's time that I'm losing, 'cause I'm waiting. The layover, I'm waiting, procrastinating. The layover,
wow. Thank you so much for coming on and just sharing that. That's amazing. Now, where can people find out more of your other stuff?
I have a website, www.dly2.com. And also, I post some snippets of music on Instagram often, and that's Instagram posting at dly2. So.
Wow, and I can only imagine what you can find on Instagram from you with such powerful and deep meaning lyrics and words. Just the snippets have to really reach out and touch people. And thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you.
Now it's time we welcome poet Scott Thomas Outler to the program. Thank you so much for coming on.
Great to be here, Matt. Appreciate it.
It's a pleasure having you. So you've got some great readings with us. You brought three pieces. And where are you coming to us from?
Just outside Atlanta, Georgia, around the Stone Mountain area.
And so have you always been drawn to poetry when it comes to writing?
Pretty much started out as a fascination with lyrics and music. And so that's how I got into poetry. And then a couple of years ago, stumbled upon Bukowski, and that really fine-tuned my style toward a more straightforward approach. It's where I've settled into at the moment.
And so how is it going back and reading some of those older pieces compared to where you're seeing your stuff now?
I tend to not do that as much anymore because just focused on the future at this point. But it's fun to go back and see where your growth has come from, and a lot more abstract in the past, half-baked. Pretty happy with the progress, though.
Well, we'd love to hear it.
This first piece is called Return of the Fission. Prometheus tasted the fire on the tip of my tongue, too explosive to steal, and he wept like a broken god hanging on the galactic cross as the sky lost all light, dimming under the weight of darkness, waiting for the next eruption while space folded inward upon itself into a state of entropy. I only exhale when the goddess begs for warmth, and my breath is nuclear in a field of salted earth, planning to erect pillars in her honor as the heavens roar and the blanket of oblivion stretches out to cover us in kisses of absolution. Two fish swim through the ocean above us, pissing wine from the barrel of Aquarius, and Dionysus dances in maddened revelry, cackling along with the chaos of our orgasmic frenzied fervor as the focus of my two eyes is shattered. The blinded orbs roll back in my head to touch a zero-point ascension, a crescendo, a climax, a cancer, a new wave cometh to burn. Return of the Fission. This one is called But. I am not in love, and so I have no one to whom I can write a love song. But her hair was lovely, and her smile was amber honey. But her lust was eager, and her comfort was an even greater gift. I cannot remember the way electric currents traveled from her fingertips to mine. But her skin was a garden, and her light was purely born within. But her breath was an ocean, and her voice was soft whispered lilacs. I am not in love, and so I have no one to whom I can sing a love song. But deep infatuation. Distance makes the heart grow fonder, so it's no surprise why I've forever been completely head over heels for a source that cannot be seen. My soul yearns with a fervent passion after that ineffable mystery of creation, which has no tangible touch, but can always be felt at the innermost core of intuition, where the soul of the matter is guided ever closer to truth. Subjectively, I dance across the woven web of synchronicity, laughing at the materialist who scoff with objective displeasure at all concerns they cannot fathom. What need have I for atomistic eyes when the most beautiful visions are found deep inside? Answers arrive in waves when least expected, from a plane of existence beyond this world of time and form, and space is just a place where I can roam freely in magnetic dreams which align my electric pulse to a frequency most divine. Deep infatuation.
Incredible. And thank you so much for taking out time and coming on with us. Now, where can everyone out there go to find more Scott Thomas Adler?
You can check me out, first of all, at the Southern Collective Experiences website. I have a page up there. And then my personal website is 17numa.wordpress.com. You can find recent links to all my published poetry and fiction and essays and reviews of my books. I have a new book coming out at the end of July called Happy Hour Hallelujah through CTU Publishing out of California. So I'm pretty excited about that. And you can also find me on Facebook and Twitter. I'd like to also mention Starline Books, local indie store here in Chattanooga, carries some of the collective's work. There's a couple of my books, Songs of a Distant, there. So if anyone can support your local community around this area, be a big help to them and us. We'd appreciate it.
Mr. Scott Thomas Adler, thank you so much.
I appreciate it, Matt. Thanks for having me.
As we return to the musical portions of Dante's Old South, we welcome a musician that I've had a chance to work with on several occasions. I've seen him play so many instruments, a great talent. Mr. Caleb Garrett, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
So I've seen you play a stand-up bass, an electric guitar, just really numerous instruments today. You brought the acoustic with you. And so how is it just switching out and going between so many instruments?
I grew up listening to such a diverse body of work that the area that I grew up in didn't have a lot of musicians, so I kind of just had to fill in when it was necessary. So I just picked up stand-up bass when it was necessary for a bluegrass band and had some good mentors along the way, and it kind of guided me.
Do you find a different voice almost coming out when you're playing different instruments, a different side of the music you create?
I would say so. I would say when I pick up a mandolin, it's definitely influenced by the, you know, the Irish folk tradition, by the people that have mentored me. Also, it has a lot to do with how they viewed the instrument and how they utilized it.
And so now, do you have one standout that you prefer to play, or they all kind of fall in the same line?
Guitar has always been my go-to instrument. It has so many applications, and Chet Atkins was always a big influence of mine. He utilized it in so many different ways and kind of had his own signature sound, but you can get so many different textures with just the one instrument.
Wow, and so with the acoustic today, what song have you brought to share with us?
I've brought a song that I've written. It's called Every Red Scent.
And so now, what inspired or what place did this come from?
All of my writing comes just all at one time, kind of just in a flood of just the thought or an idea or a place that I'm at. And I was going through an early stage of a love, and it just happened to come to me.
So a wash of passion and music flowed out the other side.
Yeah, that's a very cliche way of saying it, yes.
Well, we'd love to hear it.
Okay.
Well, if I had a nickel, that'd make 5 cents to my name. You can line my pockets with silver and gold. It would never equal up to your love, 'cause it's the love you give, it's worth every red cent on the earth. Of all these friends and lovers whose paths have never quite converged, you can put them all together, add up all their love. It would never equal up to your love, 'cause it's the love you give, it's worth every red cent on the earth. Of all these friends and just could never add up to money. If I had a nickel, that'd make 5 cents to my name. You can line my pockets with silver and gold. It would never equal up to your love. It's the love you give, it's worth every red cent on the earth.
And so now we're fortunate enough to get another great song from you this evening.
Yes, this one's called Sunshine Girl. It's going to be the title track of the album that I'm...
She's as warm as the glowing sun in the morning, shining out through the trees to break the cold night in two. Her smile's enough to make you sad and lonely when you see that she don't want nothing to do with you. 'Cause that girl my sunshine, but you'll never be mine. Sunshine girl, won't you change your mind? Once upon a time, I thought she was mine, but she rose up quicker than the morning dew. Rising up to see the world below her, rising up to break another heart in two. 'Cause that girl's my sunshine, but she'll never be mine. Sunshine girl, won't you change your mind? So just like the sun, don't look too closely. Bright as she shines, you just can't get too near. Not even she knows where she's going. I just know it isn't here. 'Cause that girl's my sunshine, but she'll never be mine. Sunshine girl, won't you change your mind? 'Cause that girl, she's my sunshine, but she'll never be mine. Sunshine girl, won't you change your mind?
Those are some incredible music and some incredible songs. Thank you, Caleb, so much. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb and guess that I'm not the only one wanting to stay up to date on this upcoming release of your new album. And so how do we do that?
Yeah, you can check me out through the Southern Collective website.
Excellent. It's be a great location then to find out when the album's coming out, your other music. And I know you play a lot of shows, so a lot of places people can find out to actually come see you live. So
yes, sir.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much, Caleb.
Thank you so much for having me.
We're very privileged right now in Dante's Old South to welcome the passion and inspiration behind a new writer's retreat coming up in September, going to be at Brasstown Valley Resort, Miss Mary Ann Stefanelli. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. So this writer's retreat that has sprang forth out of your mind's eye, where did that come from?
It came from a lot of different places. I've always loved writing, reading books, and for years I sort of put off that passion. There were a lot of issues that I dealt with, loss, death, illness, and I felt like I needed to write about them, but I just couldn't quite do it. And at a certain point in my life, things changed. It just sort of came together. And I was in the mountains at one of my favorite places and looking around, and I felt so inspired to write. And everything that I ever wanted to write about, it just, the ideas were just flowing. It was like they were just dropping out of the sky. And I realized that that was my place. That was where I found the writer's high, my writer's high. And I wanted to recreate that for other people who were other writers who were struggling like I was, who just could not quite get themselves on that path of writing, and especially writing toward healing.
Wow. And in those, because growing up young Harris, we hear about people like Byron Herbert Reese that spawned from the Appalachian Mountains. And so you're going back there with these writers, and it seems you've almost got this very broad cavalcade of just different styles coming in. You're really covering all bases when it comes to both poetry and prose.
That was a deliberate step, because obviously I'm trying to embrace as many different types of writers and genres as possible. I want people, whatever they write or whatever they want to write, I want them to feel welcomed and to know that no matter what type of genre they're writing in, they're going to find something there that's really going to speak to them and inspire and motivate them.
Wow, so this really is open arms for even down to the novice, someone that may be just dipping their feet into this well of writing.
Absolutely. Everyone is welcome. Whether it's a first-time writer, somebody who's just been contemplating it. We have some people, for example, I know who are coming in who they're scared, they're afraid, and this is the right place for them because they're going to be embraced, they're going to be welcomed, they're going to be not only nestled in these beautiful North Georgia mountains, but in the camaraderie and the generous spirit of other writers.
Wow, and so just through the passion that you're showing that's being poured into this retreat is going to have some amazing, well, creativity and just to see what's coming out the other side.
Absolutely. And there are some wonderful things that happen. Last year's retreat, the people, the writers who came last year said it was magical. I mean, that was the word that I heard over and over again. And honestly, I think that's a pretty apt description. There were some amazing success stories that came out of that. Writers who took giant steps that they never thought that they'd be able to. And
not often do we get to ask the question, how is it then for the muse to be there to see, to be putting forth this place and this energy for people to go and just really do and create?
Sometimes it's overwhelming.
And so, I mean, what just the passion that goes into it, I mean, it's your drive that will just spur and keep moving forward.
Thank you. I've been fortunate to have met so many established authors, writers, people who are just giants in the literary world. And I've been, really every single time, I've been amazed at their generosity and the kindness and the way that they remember what it was like. And they never fail to turn around and hold their hand out to somebody else who just needs that little bit of extra help to find their way. And that's what I want to do for other people.
Wow, and just being able to nurture that artistic ember and have it grow and watch it.
Oh, it's a beautiful thing. There's nothing like seeing somebody's eyes just light up. I mean, I've seen it before, and I think I probably get more excited than they do.
And it's just amazing, because in my opinion, it's not so much the outcome or the level of the art that's created, but the passion that went through the process to get there.
Absolutely, because everyone has to start at a certain point. Most people do not come into writing and write prose that's genius right off the bat. They might, and that's wonderful if that happens. But writers also need to be aware that it's a craft and it gets better. So even if you start off really beautifully, there is always room for improvement. And if you're a novice writer, that's okay too, because everybody had to start somewhere. All of these people are welcome. It's meant to be a safe place where writers can come in and either be who they are or be who they want to be.
Wow, and it seems that being such a rocky path heading down, being a writer, being a poet, just a creative person, it's easy to get dissuaded from that track. So having this place that has such a nurturing foundation really is this nice oasis.
Thank you. That's absolutely what we're trying to create there is, again, you know, a safe place where you meet people who have that similar spirit and the sense of camaraderie and the willingness and the desire to give back. Writers tend to be a lonely crew. I know for me, I do my best writing alone. And there's a lot of being alone in writing. And so when you have the opportunity to come to an event like this with other writers, people who are willing to share themselves with you, there's something amazing that happens when you get these sort of shy creative types in a room together, and all of a sudden they start talking to each other and they realize that they have all of these common threads that they never would have realized if they had stayed home. And the friendships that are made, I made two of my very best friends last year. It's amazing who you meet when you kind of come out from under that rock where you spend most of your time working or writing or thinking about writing and actually get out and meet like-minded people.
Wow. And if you were right now talking to someone that was on the fence that says, you know, I don't know if I'm good enough to go, what would you say to them?
Everybody's good enough. Everybody's good enough. There's no reason why you shouldn't write. People write for different reasons. Some people write for healing. Some people write because they want to be published. They want to build a platform. They want to become a successful author. All of these different types of writers are welcome. There is something at the retreat that will speak to all of these different types of writers.
Wow. And so for everyone out there wanting to find out about the retreat, nestled in the amazing Young Harris Mountains and up there, which is an inspirational, magical place in itself, how do they go about doing that?
Well, they could register online at www.thewritershighretreat.com. That's the easiest way.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for taking out time. And give the site just once more, because I know everybody's out there trying to grab a pen at the same time.
It's www.thewritershighretreat.com.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Matt.
Up next on Dante's Old South, we're being joined by the Orange Walls.
Well, you saw it written there, but you didn't want to go back again. So you buckled up your knees and you tried your damnedest to stand. I opened up my eyes and I saw redemption. And I laughed in your face as you were drug away. Felt the bones crush in your hand as you tried to reach for me. And I got down on my knees so I could better watch you bleed. I cast my eyes away, but I could not hold them. I wanted this to end, but it was too late. If I could, I would leave this moment. If I could, I would get away. Felt the bones crush in your hand as you tried to reach for me. And I got down on my knees so I could better watch you bleed. I begged the sun to burn my eyes forever. I looked up and the sky went gray. If I could, I would leave this moment. I've been down this road before.
I've been down this road before. Settle down, settle down. I've been looking at you, girl. I've been looking at you, girl. Just settle down, settle down. I'm changing my own notes. I've been changing my own notes. Settle down, settle down. You and I weren't meant to be, but we'll be eventually. Settle down, settle down. Because she smokes from the hip like a radiator, and her hands are still driving, sailing the salt lakes. She's got tattoos on her fingers. She's got tattoos and only she knows what they mean. And I love her, yes I love her. Oh God, yes I love her. I've been down this road before. I've been down this road before. Settle down, settle down. The little looks you give to me. Can I look back at you, please? Settle down. From the hip like a radiator, and her hands are still driving, sailing the salt lakes. She's got tattoos on her fingers. She's got tattoos and only she knows what they mean. And I love her, yes I love her. Oh God, yes I love her. And we don't have far to go. Hell, nobody needs to know. And if anyone asks our plans, you can tell them that you don't know who I am. Because you smoke on the hip like a radiator, and your hands are still driving, sailing the salt lakes. You've got tattoos on your fingers. You've got tattoos and only you know what they mean. I've been down this road before. I've been down this road before. Settle down, settle down.
That was the Orange Walls, great Butte band from Jasper, Georgia, taking out time to be with us here. Now we're being joined by poet Miss Honey Zobel. Let's pause that so I can pronounce her last name right.
It's Weibel.
This is not an exercise Weibel in trying to make your neck longer or something. We'll move to closer. There you go.
It's Weibel.
Weibel?
Zweibel.
Zweibel.
Yeah. Zweibel. Think of like, okay, think of like a shy bull. Mm-hmm. Zweibel.
Zweibel.
Zweibel. Zweibel.
German?
It is German. Mm-hmm.
All right. That was The Orange Walls, a local band from Jasper, Georgia. Right now we're being joined by poet Honey Zweibel. Thank you for taking out time and being with us.
Hi.
So where are you joining us from?
From?
Where are you from?
Oh, where am I from? I'm from Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania?
Yes.
And so?
I live in Georgia now.
What drew you to poetry?
Well, I was about 10 years old. I was sitting outside and the wind was blowing. It had picked up the boughs of the trees and they were moving. And I felt inspired by it. So I sat down and wrote a poem. That was the first poem I ever wrote. But I've always been telling stories. You know, I've always wanted to be a writer. You ask a little kid what they want to do and they say, you know, be a fireman or whatever. But I wanted to be a writer. So that's where poetry comes from.
Wow. And so how is it when you put a piece out there, something so close to you, when you share it?
Well, it's one thing to me when I write it. Mm-hmm. And then as soon as I have it written and it goes out there in the world, it's for the people who hear it. Like, I write it and it comes from in me and goes to other people. That's what art is about. It's about sharing those intimate experiences with a wider audience.
Well, we'd love to hear some of the pieces you brought today.
Okay, I have one long poem called Ancient Ache.
All right, and then I'll read the title, and then at the end say the title again.
Okay. Ancient Ache. The siren song of the open road to that place back home is a vintage wine, dandelion, poured over the roots of Appalachia, a sinuous mermaid, her long tail furling down mountains, down hills and springs and rills, gray and humming. The spirits of the dead call me, resonating from the shady green valleys where their ancient bones sleep. They say, pick up your camp from the toes of the mountains in the southern lands, and come back home, girl, come back home. Climb up hill and dell until you're back in that holler, back to Skillet Hill you go. I cannot say no, nor merely send my slumbering self. I must leave the suburban Georgian life on pause. Bowls of ice cream in the sink, Buddhist magazine on the bathroom counter, crumpled, water splattered, nearly all red. Lonely couch to keep the TV company, beside water glass empty. What I find in Pennsylvania is a place unchanging as the old mountains. Faded white farmhouse on faded gray road. Steam rises from the hollow, hangs over the horizon, spirits floating. I feel, but cannot see, ghosts walking next to me in the overgrown garden. Even the tractor is mourning, slumped and rusted in a wreath of water plants. Rain-wet grass washes my feet where spider webs are shimmering shrouds. Grief, hot like a spider bite, burns just under the skin, stinging my eyes with fresh tears. My tongue lolls around my mouth for teeth it can't find. The heart has a similar probing for the dead. They are gone. But hold on. Heartache is only the worst part. It gets better. It numbs out with time, and soon you are as gray inside as the rain is outside. And the wind whistling through your soul is still seeking, even in the howling darkness, those exquisite diamonds of light sparkling on dew-jeweled spider webs. The burnt crimson of a turned leaf lying in cold mud on the path. The warmth and the familiarity of the angles and beams in the old farmhouse. Home tastes like sorrow, but it is the same companion it has always been. Nobody promises tomorrow. We battle for it like Vikings. Heaven isn't some dream. It is the little moments that don't make it to the TV version of your life. It is the tea kettle singing merrily. It is the smell of incense and herb. It is the voice at the other end of the phone who loves you and whispers, keep going. Thank you.
Do you have a place where people can follow you, find out about your other pieces and things you have coming up?
You can find me on the Southern Collective Experience website. It's under Honey Zweibel, and you click there and it'll show you what I've done.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for coming on.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Well, it is a distinct pleasure and a great, great honor. I know I've used that word, but I also use the words like pillar and foundation when it comes to the collective, Southern Collective experience. Holly has really put forth so much effort and does so much in it that Holly Holt's name really has become synonymous with so much of the work and the backbone of the group. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Not only for taking out time, but for what you do.
Thank you.
So today you brought an essay to share with us.
I did.
What inspired this? Where did it come from?
It came from a conversation I was having with a certain dark-haired lady that Cliff knows. And we were just talking about happiness, you know, what really makes us happy. And one day, we started talking about it, and she was just saying all sorts of things about just this particular image. And it was, if you really look at it, I mean, it's really a basic image, you know, but she saw so much in it, you know, and it really got me to thinking about the different views of happiness.
Well, we'd love to hear it.
Called An Essay About Happiness. We spend our entire lives defining what it is to be human, and that process never ends, even when we think it does. After all, one would think, the body eventually wears itself out. Yet, I ask you, what of the soul, the mind? There are many who live long lives and never lose their minds, and there is, to my knowledge, no way to lose the soul. The soul, the spark that is you, is something you bring into this world that's unique and yours alone. Yet, as we go through life, each spark ignites another and another, so that when we pass on, we aren't gone. This, I believe, is what it is to love. The chance to leave yourself in the hearts of others so that the light they emit from their eyes is as much you as them. Despite our well-intended notions, we are creatures of multiple misgivings, too, and tend to regress when we place too much weight in the present moment instead of compiling all of our moments with an eye towards the future. We are always turning to the stars with thoughts of how alone we are, instead of looking around us at the unique chance we have been given to exist. Evolution brought us here, has left it up to us to realize the great qualities of our mortality, and permits us the opportunity to define ourselves as members of the human race. For this reason, one must realize the strongest states of being aren't arrived at with one heartbeat or one footstep, but stitched together with the poetry of everything we have ever been and all that we are determined to become. Happiness is one such state, and the journey towards it never ends. This tender feeling isn't definite, but provides you the courage to experience great days and know that the sun will shine the next morning. It is to look beyond the monotonous distractions of everyday life and see the bigger picture, the one painted by someone greater who knows what's better. The truest gift, the purest treasure, is to allow happiness the room to evolve to the point that it consumes you so that nothing breaks your spirit or steals your spark. Think of someone or something that makes you happy. Have they always made you happy? Certainly not, because there was a time in your life before you knew them. But still, there was someone or something else that made you happy. One day, you could be looking into your morning coffee, happy that it's Friday. The next, that cup of coffee could remind you of someone, and suddenly you find yourself happy for a completely different reason. Still, you're happy, and that's what matters. There is no child on earth who knows what will make them the happiest when they're 21, 40, or 65. Happiness, for this reason, is like water. Necessary for life, but ever-changing, and that's what makes it beautiful. This isn't to say humans are never satisfied, though our ancestors were nomadic, seeking warmer fires, richer foods,
and stronger fellowships. This is to say that we are so much like the universe, with our only limits being what we place on ourselves. Michelangelo is quoted as saying, "I'm still learning," when he was 87 years old. I sense my state of happiness won't be the same forever, nor can it, because I'm constantly defining and redefining it. Being someone who often considers the welfare of others, I hadn't thought to consider my own happiness until recently. My only consideration, as far as happiness goes, was given to the accumulation of material objects, because I have had to get by with very little. I feel that society as a whole does the same, and we cut ourselves off from each other in pursuit of, as George Carlin would say, stuff, when our species spent so much time seeking the comfort of stronger fellowships, as I previously mentioned. I can't say how I'll be able to define my happiness when my life ends, but I do believe the spark the Southern collective experience carries, and have faith that our light will shine long after we're gone.
Thank you so much for sharing that and all the work you do.
You're welcome.
Now, how do people go about finding you and the things you've written?
Typically, I guess Facebook would be the safest bet.
Right now to the microphone, we welcome Dante's Old South co-collaborator and inspiration behind the Southern Collective Experience, Mr. Clifford Brooks.
Good evening to you, sir.
Good evening. And you've got some of your works you're going to be sharing, one of which inspired, well, our opening act's musician.
Yes, the second of the two I'll be reading. The first one's about my father, and the second one is about my mom. And it's called, the first one is the Sacrament of a Father and a Son, and the second is A Promise to Mama. And DL and I were talking after the last recording here of Dante's Old South that it would be a neat endeavor for, before each performance, we would allow a poet to give one of the musicians in the group or one performing here during the next show a piece of their labors, or a musician would give a song to the poet and the poet would extrapolate something from there. And so I didn't know until 5 minutes today before we went live that DL had done something, and honestly was just extremely humbled that he had. But to kick off the pair that I have, I will begin with Promise to Mama, that DL thought so much of, and I will be eternally grateful. Promise to Mama. You told me Tuesday, it's time to simmer for my heavy mind's sake. A son shouldn't be so good at making his mama's heart break. Now, I wouldn't say how I got lost just yet, because hell is listening for me to spill my secret. Don't go blaming bad luck, because a restless soul is my undoing. I'm overdrawn at the Bank of Legion due to the price of a few sinister seasons, so I sing spirituals and think of sermons I've missed. I know there's a debt to deal with from damage done to my wrists. Yet the scars ensure I don't misplace the memory of your undeserved sorrow. You won't weep in the rain again, Mama, and my veins will be clean tomorrow. Saint of a self-destructive son, you instinctively let my hide slide. But I shall not. I cannot. When I sit down with my misdeeds, I fear it's obvious all I'm going to do is fall short of a picket fence, the wife of a quiet life, and you. Promise to Mama. And after that, we move on to my father. These being two individuals that had cameos in my first book, The Draw Broken Eyes and Whirling Metaphysics, but now, like so many other tender moments in my past and present, make it into Athena Departs, that's due out later this year. And Athena Departs really is a departure from the first book in as much as one can be from one stage of their life to the next. If you're successful in growth in any direction, that tends up to be the case. And so we move on to my daddy, Chuck Brooks, and a poem called The Sacrament of a Father and Son. Every Sunday at dawn, Dad brings his old dog to the big house. The hound always bounds towards the tool shed while Pops and I prop up against white front porch pillars. We are not ashamed, nor shun, folks across the street that shuffle single file into church. Daddy and I are not too pious, nor sinister, to mock the flock or their minister. Yet, we are two of the few who need nothing new regarding redemption. This estate is the only Eden our maligned minds believe in. Instead of seeking truth to fear it, in celebration of the Holy Spirit, we share a smoke, squint against the sun, then whisper, Amen. If that's a sin, so be it. From this quiet pulpit, we sit, seldom speaking, to coalesce behind complacent pines. We listened to wind without need to justify or defend a force that wants for nothing. 200 acres of azalea are Acadia enough for us. All of it is split by a river that has washed away loss and purged our saucy livers. We hum to hear the hymns that in this hour is hewn through a harmonica held in little Walter's hands. Infused but not abused by the blues, my father says to me with the calm of a good man, we've had our good days, son, and we've had our bad. The seraphim and cherubim hover in a hush to hear how it's done. They witness how a wise man loves his mad, soul-broken son. The Sacrament of a Father and Son. Thank you for tuning in to WUTC to hear Dante's Old South. I'm Clifford Brooks, founder of the Southern Collective Experience and author of the book The Draw of Broken Eyes and Whirling Metaphysics. To find my book and others, visit Starline Books right here in Chattanooga, Tennessee. To discover more about those you heard here today, visit www.southerncollectiveexperience.com. And now I give a deep bow of gratitude to those here with me tonight, which included Connie Zweibel, Holly Holt, Marianne Stefanelli, The Orange Walls, Caleb Garrett, D.L. Yancey II, Scott Thomas Outler, and the incomparable Matt Youngblood. It's always new and never boring on Dante's Old South. This is indeed a program where listeners hear songs, stories, stanzas, and their real-world applications. Y'all, please stay safe and cool this summer. Dream big, but live bigger.